if we can look at those as we go through next week, we'll kind of get a gentlemen, I'm sorry that I'm pushing you so hard, but this is our fourth lesson. And we're going over an awful lot of territory in a hurry. All right? Just this evening's lesson can take between 7 and 9 weeks to go through. And we're not going to do it in near that detail or anything. But the point is, we're covering a lot of territory. It's almost like a flyover of how do we get to be God's mighty men. And some of the nuts and bolts of how do we make it work. And if it's really, really, I get what I want, we'll have a huge argument next week. And then we'll see whether or not you actually had a chance to read through those rules and see how to do it. And we'll get a chance to practice a little bit. All right? Now, sorry, we jumped ahead a little bit. We're trying to get to the point where we can think like Christians. And we have to realize what we're vulnerable to, what we're likely to get hooked into, and what people use against us if we're not aware of it, and how we can be prepared so we can say, okay, I like you, I like some of the things that you do, I like the person that you are, but I don't necessarily have to go along with all of that rhetoric. Okay, so let's go back over real quickly what we did. The first week we talked about how we have to follow the first commandment. All right? And the first commandment is, no other gods before me. I have to be in control. Put yourself off of the leadership. Let me be up there. Don't let your own agenda take over what I've given you. We said in that first lesson, we are so saturated. We are so fully soaked up with our own culture or with our own past, our own history, that sometimes it's hard to sort it out. Okay? Did I tell you the story of how easily we get soaked up with our culture, with our background? I don't think I told you that story. When I was just a young man, I had a little baby. His boy, the boy's name was Jonathan. Beautiful red-headed child. But he was a handful. He tested me. He was one of these children that always test the limit. And at one point, I was a college kid, and I was studying, and in the little mobile home that we had, and then he had disobeyed again and again and again and again and again. And I said, without even thinking about it, without any preparation, and I said, buddy, if you do that again, I'm going to nail your hide to the wall. And then I sat down in my chair and I said, where did that come from? Where did that come from?
Intolerance.
And then I got to thinking, that's what my dad said. Yeah. All the times I was disobeying or causing problems, I don't want to nail your hide. Oh, what does it mean? I have no idea what it means. What could it cause? Well, Jonathan took me completely off guard. I mean, being a little kid, he said, how long till I can get down? completely disarmed me. What it meant was he had grown up back on the farm, and when they'd shoot a deer or a raccoon or whatever, they would skin it, and they'd use a net, a few tacks, and put it up on the barn siding. When a guy came through collecting pelts, he'd pay them for the things that they had tacked up on the barn siding so they wouldn't just shrink up and shrivel. And he was going to tack the hides to the barn wall. Okay? Well, I never had that picture. I didn't know what that meant. But our minds are made like a VCR recorder. It records every sound, every thought, every memory, not only both in visual and audio, but it records the emotion as well. All right? And if they're doing brain surgery on you, I hope they don't, but if someday they do, one of the things that they do, well, they will often reach in with probes with a little electric currents, and they'll touch on the surface of the brain and ask you what you see. And people will relive experiences in full color, in total recall, the dust floating in the sunlight through the window and the smell of the old sofa in the front parlor that nobody ever used, and it kind of smelled musty and closed up in there where only company sat. And that they've got all these memories, and they're all just an electric probe away, and all of a sudden it's all recorded. Now, when we're stressed, when we get down, when we get sort of down to the limits of our own coping strength, our brain is designed in such a wonderful manner that it pulls out one of these old cassettes out of the library, plug it in, and we will play out something from a past experience in current time that may or may not be appropriate in the new situation. But you'll talk to couples and you'll find they have the same arguments over and over and over again. And usually it isn't an intention. So we're going to have the argument of today. It's going to be argument number 86. My dad. We get these old things and they just play them in. And we plug in argument 84 and we do it again. All right? Very often we get into repetitive things. We do the same things. So what we do is the first thing we have to do is we realize before I can really let God have control, I've got to step out of the driver's seat and take my spot in the appropriate place. Let him be the leader. All right? Because I have a lot of things that I'll mess up if I don't let him be the leader. And it's a constant struggle to put ourselves over in the passenger seat and let him be the leader. All right? And then we talk the second week about meekness. And what is the definition of meekness? The meek shall inherit the earth, which is a pretty good inheritance.
Well, it all depends on what conditions.
I'm very hopeful. Yeah. All right? I'm very hopeful. I stay hopeful. What's meekness?
Humility.
Humility? Yeah, but we had a special definition for it. Remember what we said? It's power that has been harnessed and under authority. Okay? Power. Jesus was the most powerful man that ever lived, but he was also the meekest person who ever lived. And so when it was his time to be arrested, he just let himself be arrested. And in the process, Malchus had his ear cut off, and Jesus said, but just hold on, I got to put this back in. He still had the power, even though he was in bondage, to his captors. You think Samson could have broken those bonds? Yeah. If he could break them, Jesus could have broken them. But instead, he stayed bound, even when he had the power to put Malchus's ear back on. Right? Harnessed power. Not my will. He'd already put that on the altar, but thine be done in God. Okay? Harnessed power. My dad tells about back when he was in Pennsylvania, his family broke horses, sold cattle and livestock. And he said they would bring in all these big Mustang horses that were wild. And they had to break them. And he said, we had a wonderful track record. We had some people that used to say, we could put shoes on the devil if we could get a rope on him. Okay? Sometimes they actually had to take the head and put a rope around behind on the neck, behind the head, and a rope under the tail, and pull the head and the tail together with a rope. So that the horse couldn't do anything. I mean, he was just basically dancing around in a circle until that horse was broken enough that he'd stand still, and then they could release the tension on the rope, and then he'd just follow whoever it was that held the rope. An undisciplined man, God's mighty men, has to be broken in order to be useful. To work in the harness, to have to be a useful instrument. If a horse couldn't be broken, it was both a danger to have around and a useless wasting of resources to feed him. So a horse had to be broken in order to be used. And so that was the second one. Then the third one is the military siege. And we talked about the circular firing squad. We talked about how we get into other things. I brought another picture of that same kind of thing this week. This is the way a real army lines up in Roman times, in biblical times. All right? Every part of the army has a role to play. All right? This is the goal over here. This is the city they're trying to take over. All right? This is where the defenders are protecting it. We've got our foot soldiers out here in the front with all the shields. And in Roman times, those shields were devised in such a way so that if you were walking along, you could hook your shield into the one next to you, and it became like an impenetrable wall. And you could hold them up over your head and keep things from falling on you. And there was nothing that could get through. It was like a total barricade. And so the foot soldiers were a pretty effective force to go up here and approach the wall. And behind them were the archers, and they were actually leveling any defenders that might be ahead of the foot soldiers with a barrage of arrows that was weakening the resistance of the people who were the foot soldiers were going to take over. And then behind them were the people working the catapults, because they would throw large objects, sometimes fireballs, whole bonfires. They would throw them over the wall to set the city on fire behind the defenders.
The catapults.
Mm-hmm. And then down here were the engineers, what we call the CBs in my branch of the service. And they were working on the siege works. And these would be the big rolling things that would go up against the gate and would pound through the doors so they could pound the doors down. And then over here were the camps, the support camps. And so it was demoralizing for the people standing up here to see not only the army laid out in front of them, but all these support camps. Because once these guys are tired, there's more coming. They're just waiting back here in the camps. And they're going to switch out with new ones and come after you again.
Where's the camps?
Well, this is
Roman times.
And the cavalry's on both sides, so I guess we call them the tanks.
Yeah.
And that's only to try and keep the focus. They didn't want to get hit from the side, so they had to have highly mobile defenses on the ends of their battle lines. This is why we want to become God's mighty men. If we don't line up with each other to fill our role, if we don't harness our power and our strength to become a part of the overall plan, if you happen to be a horse soldier over here, and you say, but I really wanted to be an archer, were you likely to get transferred over into the archery division? Once I was put in the black gang in the Navy, I had to work on the equipment down in the bowels of the ship. I couldn't just say, hey, I want to be a deckhand. You do what's given to you to do. And the Navy in its wisdom put me in the right spot. I was pretty good at fixing things, and they put me in the right. But you see how in a men's group, very often what's happened is that we get people who all want to be generals, or all want to be foot soldiers, all want to be alike. Okay,
so
turn to Ephesians. Turn to Ephesians.
Because this is nothing new for us.
Yeah. Oh, no. Ephesians 4:11. All right, we're going to talk about this for just a second.
It's not against what you said, brother, but... we should go, what is the word?
Here we have two spokes on this wheel, all right? If you'll notice, I put a pink strip around here so that you can see each one of these is fastened on the side of the hub, one side and then the other. And then they're fastened down here on the wheel. That keeps the hub on a particular level. It keeps it straight. But what about these two up here with the other pink one? They're going a different direction. They're off on an angle. Do you realize when we bring a wheel in to repair, you tap on the spokes, they will tell you whether or not that wheel is healthy or not, just by the song that they sing when you tap on them to see if they've got the right tension. All right? It's called tuning a wheel.
Yeah, it's like a piano.
It's just like piano wires. I may have, this may be me, okay, these two right here are me. I'm pretty well balanced, I'm in pretty good condition, I'm doing my job. What happens if these two down here get slack and they're not doing everything they're supposed to do? the whole wheel fails. I was following a little motor scooter the other day, and they'd worn it out, the spokes, and the wheel was just doing this. And it was very difficult for him to stay in the seat, because the wheel was doing all of this because one group of spokes or another weren't doing their job. When we get into the Bible and we look at how the body of Christ is put together, we find that we each have spokes. We have a job to do, a role within the family, that we have to do our part of it in order to be able to have a healthy alignment and keep everything in tune and singing just the right pitch. Okay? He, Jesus Christ, who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, and to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we reach full unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And what that means is, we are fulfilling the role that God has given us to do within the body. We're tuned up. We're one of the spokes that's singing just right, with the right tension. But you know, it's difficult when we're in a body and we're not all doing the same thing. Okay? We get to be sometimes in a little bit of a competition. Which one is more important? Remember the disciples coming to Jesus and said, who's going to be most important in the kingdom? Okay? I had a pastor friend of mine one time that said, the only really important gift that God gives to use in the church is the gift of evangelism, because it's the only gift where it brings people into the fellowship and it brings them into a new relationship with Jesus Christ. All the rest of the gifts are worthless.
Supporting spokes in that wheel.
He just took his wire nippers and went, oh, and the whole wheel started coming undone. All right?
Assuming he's an evangelist.
And he wanted to be with people just like himself. Please understand. If you've ever understood the role of a pastor, you'll realize that God has a real sense of humor. He calls us, empowers us, changes us. But he didn't give us all of the gifts. He only gives us part of it. He gives us our little portion. And so when I hear people talking about it, I had a friend of mine just recently said, my friend told the church that he would only be the pastor there for 15 years. And then at the end of 15 years, he's going to move. And I kind of smiled and I said, good luck with that. I hope around 7 or 8 you don't realize that you're not going to make it all the way. Why do we have to move pastors? Even then, I mean, he said 15 years. And he was trying to say, I want to set the expectation of a long, stable pastoral ministry. Right? Why do we move pastors?
Sometimes you retune the church.
If we don't have a healthy church that realizes that every pastor, every group can only do certain things and reach certain people, and only accomplish a certain portion of what God has intended for a church to accomplish, and we stay with one person too long, we penalize the church. Okay? We penalize the church. I have a friend of mine in Indiana. He was the founding pastor of the church, is still the pastor of the church. He spent his whole lifetime at the church. The church is absolutely unhealthy. Why? It never developed its own personality. The people who have other gifts couldn't come in and build around him. And they needed to be able to develop their own identity as a congregation separate from this individual with their own set of gifts.
Plus, the new pastor.
We like to be with people who are like us. And we like to have a sense that we're like everybody. If everybody's like us, then we don't feel like losers, or if we don't feel like we have to compete with anybody else. We're all in this, let's have the same little bundle of gifts. Okay? But God, in 1 Corinthians 12, 13 and 14. 13 is the love chapter, but you go to 1 Corinthians 12, and you go through the list of gifts, and you look at the, how they're to be applied. He was actually in direct violation of what God's word says in 1 Corinthians 12, 14. The list of gifts. If you look at gifts, just as an overview, there are basically about 19 spiritual gifts. All right, some of them are overlapped, but basically there are about 19. And I guess if you counted, martyrdom is considered one of the gifts, so but you only get a chance to use that once. So that there are a couple that you might get that all bring it up to 21. But basically you have about 19 gifts. There are 19 spokes in the wheel. All right? And if we have all of a healthy body and we put it all together, the foot can't say to the eye, I don't need you. All right? You're going to find that kind of discussion going on here in 1 Corinthians. One can't say, I'm superior to another. Because even those that are given special kind of private respect are important parts of the body. All right? And so he was in direct violation of Scripture, and that's just part of who we are. Sometimes we're not as faithful as we should be. All right? And when we're talking about the spiritual gifts, everybody has four basic ways that the gifts permeate. All right? And they're the four P's. If you want to write down a thing or two, that we have our own personality. I don't have the same personality as someone else. Someone said you had a gift of gab, but you got too much of it all the time. All right? Some people are more shy and reserved and more quiet. So the gifts?
Is it the gift?
No, we have our personalities. But the gift of, let's say, evangelism or teaching can come through a quiet personality just like it can from a verbose personality. All right? My wife is a gifted teacher, but she's very quiet. So we come through our personality, and then we come through our passions. All right? Not everybody has the same desire, life goal, the same
drive.
Perfect drive. The drive, what we want to accomplish, what we're doing. We all have some of the same fears. We have the same basic, what would you say? We have the same underlying mechanisms that drive us. But I had a wonderful, wonderful youth leader back a number of years ago. And he was completely consumed with his youth program, his teenagers. And he was good at what he did. Tremendous. And one day he took me aside and he said, Pastor Douglas, we just got the wrong people in the wrong spots in this church. We've got a board of education that's supervising the youth program that doesn't have a passion for youth like I've got. And then, and, you know, I come up with an idea of how we're going to do this, and then they sit around and say, well, we don't have the resources to do that, and they don't have the passion that I've got. And so, you know, we've got the wrong people on the wrong job. And I think we ought to replace a bunch of the members on the Board of Education. And I said, you know what? You're right. I don't have the right people in the right jobs. And I need a worship leader to really come across with some excitement and joy in the fellowship. And then I went down through about two or three other ones. And then I said, I need a youth leader who can see himself as a part of a larger program and not just be a lone wolf out there trying to do his own thing, whether anybody else approves or not. His face fell. Ears kind of came down. He said, yeah, I guess you're right. You have a youth ministry, and it's all that works. You're going to have an unhealthy church.
That's all that works.
If that's all that works, if that's the only thing that you're spending all your resources on, that's where you're throwing all of your personnel. That baby is going to fold. You got to be a part of a larger body. You have to see yourself within the framework of all the rest of the people in the fellowship. And so when we stop and we think about our passion, I don't want it to be one bit less passionate about his youth program. I don't want him to give up his passion or his personality because it was working. But you have to see it as how it fits in. And then we have our priorities. I once had a guy that would have spent every dollar that came into his possession on his own ministry. He had his priorities, and boy, he went after it. Whatever it was, he went after it. I've had people within my own family, passion of missions, Haiti missions especially. All right? Everything that about their lives seemed to be focused on somehow promoting and building up toward the mission work in Haiti. And then we have our past. I don't know whether you realize it or not, but you are a person who has a unique past. Nobody else in here has had the same one. And that changes who you are and makes you unique in this group, in this fellowship. And so, you've got the gift. Okay, let's just pretend that you've got somebody with the gift of evangelism. But you have a past where you have had so many failures in your life that until you actually get your act together, nobody's going to listen to you. So you're going to be on what we might call in the body of Christ limited duty until you can get yourself together. And you can get focused on one. Now, you can have the same excitement, you can have the same passion, you have the same drive, but sometimes we have past that shapes who we are today. We have to use our past as a guide for how to help us to have a ministry in the future. Not that we're bound by it, not that we're restricted, but we have to learn and understand. So the same gift, through a different personality, through a different set of passions, a different set of priorities, and even a different past, can look differently in the way it's applied. I'm not saying that they can't, but one of the things that we come back to is that really the point of what the discussion was is we are unique, even though we have 19 of the same gifts, and we have them in unique mixtures. Almost everybody has one primary gift and two or three that will follow along in kind of a combination with that. So it's like many thousands of different combinations that can come together. Then you filter those through people who have different personalities. All right? I was in a study one time with a bunch of pastors, and they were saying there are four groups of personalities. And they gave them animal names. One was a turtle. If anything dangerous happened, they'd pull their head in. And one was a teddy bear. They just want everybody to hug and be, you know, supportive. And they had, I don't know, four different animals they had in this. And one of them was a tiger. And if you were a tiger personality, that you would be one that would launch into any kind of a situation to try and do something, to assert yourself in there. And I had a wonderful friend who said, "Well, boy, if there's anything at all, I'm sure not a tiger." And the whole group within the whole pastor section just broke into riotous laughter. You know why?
That's
exactly who we are. Even though we have the same list of gifts, and we filter them through personalities, through our passions, through our priorities, through our past, it's all unique. But we have to simply say we're only a part of the whole body. Mm-hmm. If one part tries to become something it's not, the body becomes unhealthy and unbalanced. I had a pastor friend of mine, I won't say where, he's no longer with us, but he preached every single Sunday. He was the only pastor that was preaching it right in the whole area, and everybody else wasn't doing it right, and his congregation was the only one doing it right. And it was proved because his was the only congregation growing in the whole town, the whole area. And he just preached it and preached it and preached it and preached it. He didn't see himself as a part of a larger fellowship of churches or a body of pastors or a body in the church. He saw himself as the key that held everything else together.
But he didn't need a lot of those other pastors.
Oh, believe me, there was a lot of irritation.
Sure.
But what happened when for 3 years his church didn't grow? What do you suppose happened when 3 years he had to report that there had been no growth?
People started leaving. They went to another church.
He went to a different church and started over. And you know what? That church has had three pastors since. And they're all dealing with the same problem. Because that church bought into the fact that we're the only one doing it right. We're not a part of a fellowship. We're not a part of a body where everybody... When I went to seminary, I had a Presbyterian pastor who was my church history pastor. Tremendous guy. Had a Lutheran pastor who was the head of my systematic theology department. All right? Had a Messianic Jew who was my Old Testament professor. I had a professor from Fuller Theological Reformed Church as my New Testament professor. I had a Church of God pastor for my worship pastor, preaching pastor. Why would they have, and we had a Lutheran bishop, a Church of the Brethren bishop who was the president of the seminary. Now why do you suppose you put an accumulation of people like that together?
You share their talents.
They taught us what each group brought to the mixture that was of value. I wish we'd have had a Baptist online. I wish we'd have had a priest. You know why? Because there's real value in what that Catholic Church brings to our church doctrine that we in the Protestant Church miss. Where does our salvation come from?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
And by?
Grace.
Faith alone.
Basically, yeah.
Where does it say doctrine saves you?
Who's paid to please Jesus?
No.
I never
we do.
I meant never please you.
Because we tend to say we're the ones with the right doctrine.
Right.
I mean, there are people who are asking people to accept Jesus Christ all over the world. Mm-hmm. Of different groups, of different faiths, of different movements, of different organizations. And they're coming into the family all alike. I diminish what someone else is, the value of what somebody else is doing. And gentlemen, it's like this. We all know the value of what we teach and the truth of what we teach. We don't always see the negative side of what we teach and the problems that it creates. Okay? Because we have done it so long, we're permeated by it. So we've become convinced of what we know, and that's what we believe, and we hold on to it, but we don't know, like the brother that was my seminary president, or the man who was my Lutheran systematics theology professor, or my Presbyterian church history pastor. We don't know what other people are bringing to the mixture that have equal value, even though it's a little different slant on the thing than what we've always known. Do you follow? And so we have to recognize that there are things that are normal. They're being taught, and it doesn't hurt, it doesn't cause problems. It's just a part of the process, and we have to recognize the value of what they're doing and how we all fit into this great complexity of the kingdom of God.
Yes.